Extraordinary Phenomena Investigations Council presents Epic Voyages. Come join us as we enter and experience the great mysteries of the world with tonight's host, Chase Kloetzke.
Welcome to Epic Voyages. I am Chase Kloetzke, and I am the Director of Investigations, or as I like to call myself, Ken's number two, and I will be your host tonight with everyone's favorite producer, J.B. Havigan. I'm very excited to bring you this show tonight, and we're live with such an interesting guest and topic, Joshua Shapiro, the original Crystal Skull Explorer, has been on this journey since 1983. Of course, the general public learned more about the reality of the Crystal Skulls through the fourth installment of the Indiana Jones in 2008, created by the team of Lucas and Speilburg. But Joshua Shapiro and his partner, Katrina Head, share through their books and lectures what is the true reality of these Crystal Skulls and how they can be a powerful tool to help humanity. The new book on the Crystal Skull deals with two special travels to Mexico City in 2009 by the Crystal Skull Explorers and what wonders and new skulls were discovered. In the first part of the book, Mr. Shapiro encounters very old skulls held by the well-known Mexico TV journalist and UFO researcher Jaime Maussan. He's so darling, right? And the famous muralist Master Rosales. In the second part of the book, the explorers attend a very special crystal skull conference where even more crystal skulls and information is revealed. It is a well-known fact that within the crystal skull community that Mexico is a key area on our planet where numerous mysterious skulls are being discovered. I really, really would like to welcome our next guest. He is the author of various books, including his first book about the Crystal Skulls entitled Mysteries of the Crystal Skulls Revealed. And that was written jointly with Sandra Bowen and the late F.R. Nick Nocerno. This book was published in 1989, and there is also a Portuguese edition issued in Brazil in 1993. He has released various versions of his book, Journeys of the Crystal Skull Explorer, since 2004, and as an ebook and printed edition in three foreign languages in Europe. I'm almost done, guys, but this guy is so spectacular and special. It's a little longer intro tonight. But Joshua is the co-founder of VJ Enterprises in Illinois, which has been in operation since 1992. Dedicated to sharing the best information that describes how our planet will be transformed into a golden age by the year 2013. Additionally, Joshua has offered a number of other public talks throughout the world that discusses current information about UFOs, the Bible Code, and the Hollow Earth. He is actively involved with the nonprofit organization, the World Mystery Research Center. This foundation is dedicated to studying various world mysteries, which are believed inherently to contain vital encoded information necessary to create a peaceful world. He is the originator of a story for an action adventure film that portrays how world peace will happen by the end of 2012, waiting to be made. The script is complete. Hello, Joshua, and thank you for joining us tonight on this special epic voyage. How are you?
I'm doing well, Chase, and I wonder as I listen to that long introduction if I actually did all those things.
I'm sure you have, and your research is just amazing. I have to admit, the crystal skulls I've always been interested in, but didn't really know too much about until we wanted to do a show about them. And as I started researching, of course, your name came up, and I was just blown away at the amount of information that you and your partner have produced. It's amazing. Can you tell our audience what is a crystal skull exactly?
Well, obviously, as the name implies, we're dealing with a piece of quartz crystal that's in the shape of a human bone skull. And as you already mentioned, there were a great number of these crystal skulls that started coming out of Mexico in the 1800s, and it continues. As our new book that you mentioned discussed in 2009, we had a table at the conference there, and there must have been like 40 or 50 skulls, and I practically had never seen hardly any of them. So when I first started studying crystal skulls in the 1980s, there were only a few of them that were known, and now they're just coming out of the woodwork. So I believe it's a sign that the crystal skulls are becoming more important. There are three different classifications of crystal skulls that are discussed within the crystal skull community. My co-author, Mr. Nasserino, through the Crystal Skull Society International, basically came up with this, and people work with it. We have what we call ancient crystal skulls, old crystal skulls, and new crystal skulls. The new crystal skulls are the ones that are being carved today, of which there are thousands of them. We recently just connected with some master carvers in China. So if there are any people that see us in the near future as we get ready to do some more of our tours, we are going to have a very special crystal skull traveling with us, and that's all I will say about that one. The old crystal skulls are ones which were made about 100 years and then maybe up to about 1,000 or 1,500. And then ones that are older than 1,500 or 2,000 are called ancient. But the major challenge is I don't know if we really have an absolute technique. I mean, there's different investigators and researchers who believe they can tell by the way that the crystal skull is formed or carved, whether it's ancient or old. Some people can tell if they're sensitive to energy, because the crystal skulls, especially the older ones, have a great deal of energy around them. But there's no definitive way that I know to say whether one is ancient or old. But then if we listen to our own crystal skulls that we have, which we have 10 right now, and they are consist of a living intelligence, they tell us what difference does it make, how old and how long ago it was carved. The key is how are the crystal skulls benefiting the people who are their guardians or who see them. So I think that would be a good definition.
Oh, absolutely. When did this start? Can you tell us how the skulls were, you know, made known actually?
Well, the crystal skulls were first there was an interest in them, let's say, in the 1800s. There were several large museums that decided to display antiquities. And so as they were uncovering these crystal skulls out of Mexico, there were a few museums that started to display them. In particular, I think there was a museum in Mexico City, which we may have passed when I was traveling there, that had a crystal skull. There was a museum in Paris called the Trocadero Museum, and now I keep forgetting the name of the new museum that this small clear quartz skull was transferred to, but it's near the Eiffel Tower in Paris. And then you have a crystal skull that's in the British Museum that's been there since 1897. So there were a number of skulls that came out in the 1800s. Not a lot of attention was given. I really think the modern age of studying crystal skulls begins when the Mitchell Hedges crystal skull comes out, which according to the current guardian, Bill Holman, who inherited the skull from Anna Mitchell Hedges when she passed away in 2007. They claim that in 1923, while they were doing an expedition in Belize, in an ancient ruined Mayan city called Lubantum, which means city of fallen stones, this crystal skull appeared, and the local natives purportedly were recognizing it as a sacred object to them. So I would say Mitchell Hedges' crystal skull coming out named after the explorer, which is an absolutely almost exact duplicate to the human bone skull. This really started the greatest interest in the crystal skulls. And I'd say within the last 10 or 15 years, it's just every year more skulls are coming out, more people are feeling drawn to them. It's almost impossible for Katrina and I to keep up with all the activities that are happening now around crystal skulls.
Right. You mentioned when they first saw that, that they knew that it was something very sacred and special, religious. Was that the word that you used?
Yes. When we've talked to different people who I would say are connected to indigenous cultures, especially in the Mayan culture, they always talk about crystal skulls as being sacred objects. So for them, and probably some Native Americans as well, though the Native Americans don't always talk about crystal skulls, the idea of buying and selling of skulls is, they don't understand this. This isn't what it's about. And I would say from my experience of meeting many crystal skulls of all three different types, which I mentioned before, you know, my real sensing is that they're a tool here to assist humanity. But then I remember there was one Native American elder that we interviewed, and his interview actually is on our new website, which hopefully we can mention before we leave, because I worked extremely hard before this interview to get it completely ready.
We will get that up in chat. Absolutely. We'll keep bringing it and posting that.
That'll be great. So anyway, this elder's name was Two Bears. Met him at a peace conference. He was a very amazing person who had a connection with crystal skulls, and he basically said it doesn't matter how the crystal skulls are found or how they go to the individual. Again, he was talking about how are the crystal skulls used and utilized. So part of what I've tried to do in the work is to look at it both from a paranormal perspective and, if possible, a scientific perspective to try to explain to people why there's this energy around crystal skulls and how it's affecting people. So I don't know if I have all the answers to that, but we've done some interesting research that have helped us to better understand maybe a little bit more how that works.
Right. You mentioned a paranormal aspect or investigation technique. Can you tell us a little more about how you handled that part?
Sure. Well, the only statement I could make with absolute certainty is that many of the older skulls, and including newer skulls, depending upon who their guardians are and how they're working with them and activating them, are broadcasting an electromagnetic frequency, which is different than the Indiana Jones film showed in 2008 with only a magnetic energy. In our experience, it's been electromagnetic energy, which, of course, the human body emanates an electromagnetic energy. I think the aura is connected to this. So if you have an active skull, it's going to affect a person on many levels. But what these crystal skulls seem to do, the easiest way I can explain it is they're like a recording device which is recording on a vibrational frequency. Now, I'm going to hope that most of your listeners are students of the paranormal or spiritual type of studies.
I believe they are, and especially in our chat room, we have an amazing audience that listens in.
Okay, well, this was my understanding. Okay, so everything is vibrations. And what I think the crystal skulls are doing is they are recording everything that's going on from a vibrational frequency. So it means if there's a sensitive or a person who's sensitive or a medium that has a crystal skull around, there are different things that could happen. Number one, I already mentioned for myself, I'm having communication with the skulls. Well, obviously I'm using some form of telepathy. In my case, the way it works is they're projecting some kind of information and I'm hearing it as my thinking voice, but I didn't think that. And, you know, like the skulls will say, hey, dad, they call me dad. And of course, Miss Katrina is their mom. You know, we want to be outside more, or don't leave us in the bag, or hand us to this person. Or we want to go like Portal de Luz, which is our largest skull at the moment. He had told me when I was in Europe, he would keep screaming at me, say, take me to the crop circles. So what I'm trying to share is these electromagnetic frequencies that are around the skulls are going to affect people in a different way. Like some people may have profound dreams after they meet a crystal skull. Some people's spiritual gifts may all of a sudden manifest. Like I remember one time, There was a gentleman in Indianapolis who was working with Portal de Luz in a private session, which is also what we do, so people can have their direct experiences with what we call, our crystal children. All of a sudden, his third eye just popped open. So naturally, after that session happened, I talked to Portal de Luz, and I said, how come you're helping this guy with his third eye, and I can't see these things? You know, he helps me in different ways. So, but that's just the way it works. Everybody has the right timing for when they become open to paranormal things, till they have their UFO experiences, till they get messages about who they are and what they're here to do. So I think what the crystal skulls are doing is they're amplifying what's going on in the area. They're doing healings. One quick example I can think of that is there's an ancient crystal skull called Ami, A-M-I, which means friend, that one of the guardians unfortunately passed away, was a good friend of mine. He had some problem with a vessel, blood vessel in his head. They did surgery. They warned him because he was quite old. If they did the surgery, he could become like a vegetable. He did. But then he was able to communicate somehow to his family to put the back of his head to the back of that skull on the ground. And all he did is thought, I'm going to be well, I'm going to be well. And he fully recovered, and no medical person could figure out how he could recover from such a serious condition. So,
best story ever. I love those stories. Exactly. And experiences. I shouldn't say stories. I kind of don't like that word. That's an amazing experience.
Right. Well, I'll give you one of mine that I like.
Actually, I'd love to hear, basically maybe some of your most profound experiences in presence of the old skulls as well. Can you add that too?
Yeah. Well, I'll give you one experience with Portal de Luz that I think is good, and then with the Mitchell Hedges skull, which is the one that I've resonated the most with of all of them. Okay, so what happened is, Portal de Luz, as I told you, asked me, go into the crowd circles. So we started to do this, and what our idea was is the crowd circle researchers have devices that they can measure frequencies of energies that are appearing in the crowd circles. So David Kingston was the crowd circle researcher in England that I was with. He came to the first crystal skull lecture I ever did in England in 2001, and we became friends. And so I said, David, I met this crop circle that has like a yin-yang pattern. It was near Avebury. And so he took us back there, and I said, what I would like to do is I would like to see if this crystal skull that we have in any way could disrupt or change the frequency of energy in the crop circle. So that was our experiment. So first what he did is he did a measurement with an electromagnetic meter, to see where the energy was. And then we focused on the center of the crop circle. And what we found at the center of the crop circle is the meter would always be zero. Now, when I put Portal de Luz at the center, thinking, okay, if we put a crystal skull there, maybe it will change that meter. Initially, it did not. But what he did, and there were three of us present who saw it, including myself and David Kingston, is we saw inside of Portal de Luz what looked like a spiraling energy, spiraling in and spiraling out very fast. So if that's happening, logic dictates it would negate itself and the reading would be zero. So Portal de Luz was trying to show us what was going on. But then before, when I had visited this crop circle a couple of days earlier, he had yelled at me and said, look, I want you to meditate with me in the crop circles with my favorite music, which is Pachelbel's Canon in D. So I had that CD with my portable CD player, and I was prepared the second time at the same crop circle to meditate with that music with him and see what happens. So now this could be a UFO contact. I don't know. I can only tell you what happened as I began to do the meditation. As soon as I started meditating with him to the music, I felt like a cone of energy surround me. My eyelids started fluttering extremely fast. There was nothing I could do to control it because it was the energy that I was linking into that this is how I was responding to it. And then I thought, I like this song. I'm going to sing with it. And I thought I was singing it in perfect pitch. But after I finished my meditation, which was about 8 minutes most likely, everybody looked at me and said, what song were you singing? So I don't know what was happening to me while I was doing this meditation, if maybe part of me was in some other place or how it was affecting me. But anyway, it was a powerful meditation. So then what we did is we took the crystal skull, put it in the center, and the energy measurement was off the scale. So conclusion could be that a human being working with a crystal skull has the capability of activating its energy and whatever is its service or function to assist other people. And that frequency was powerful enough to change the energy at the center of this crop circle. So that was pretty interesting. So let's move on to an ancient skull. Now, this is a new skull I'm talking about, made by a Brazilian carver named Leandro de Souza, which I received in 1999 at a crystal skull conference in Sedona, Arizona. So we're talking about working with the skull probably for a couple of years before we started doing all these tests. Now, one other thing I would mention, and, you know, it's kind of like I feel like his papa. So sometimes when these strange things happen, I'm proud of him, let's say. There was a Mayan shaman that we met in Holland, and Portal de Luz told me, don't say anything to the Mayan shaman. He was just sitting on the table. I guess this Mayan shaman was helping to promote a movie about the 2012 prophecy. And the Mayan shaman came up after being translated from Spanish by a friend there and said, this is an ancestral Mayan crystal skull. You need to give it back to us. And I said, no, grandfather, this is not. This is a new skull. I've met the carver in Brazil who's made it. But it was initiated by his priest in Sedona, Arizona, when I first received it, and it was sitting next to an ancient skull called E.T. So now let's move on to the experience with the Mitchell Hedges skull. So as you can imagine, in 2008, as the Indiana Jones film is getting ready to come out, finally, all of a sudden, all these media people are taking notice. Because if Spielberg and Lucas are going to include a crystal skull in their movie, then there must be some reason why they decided to do it. Of course,
right.
those of us who are researchers, we know why they included it. And I also agree, at least with this part of the movie, that there definitely is a UFO connection with crystal skulls. But that's another story. So anyway, I had a chance to work with Bill Holman because I was in Chicago and he was in Indiana. And for the sci-fi interview, which they did not air, I did that in his home. And then there was another interview, which I think has been shown on the History Channel and Discovery, which they did show part of the interview. He also, I worked with him and the skull on that. So we were kind of bumping into each other February, March of 2008. So after we had this contact, I said, Bill, you know, I would really love if I could come to your house and, you know, just have a private session with the crystal skull. I really have not had a great opportunity to do it. Probably the last time was back in, I can't even remember, I guess the 1980s, 1986 at a conference in Dallas. So we're talking about like 25 years, not quite 25 years, 22 years later. So he said, okay, you can come over, no problem. So one of the important things, anyone that's listening, if you have your own quartz crystals or crystal skulls or special gemstones, I highly recommend this. If you have a chance to meet any of the ancient skulls and the guardians will allow you to put the stone in their presence, you should do it. Because when you do it, there's going to be a transfer of energy, knowledge, information, all kinds of things that you can take that crystal skull or stone home and work with it. So I had three crystal skulls at this time, Portal de Luz. I had a small smoky quartz skull and a small rose quartz skull. So what I did is I decided I would put them in a triangular pattern around the Mitchell Hedges skull, which was on a low table in front of me. Portal de Luz was facing the face of the Mitchell Hedges skull, and the other two skulls were behind it, creating this triangle. Now, the other necessary ingredient for me was an MP3 player. Now, one of the gifts that I have, which I kind of demonstrate in my public lectures and so forth, is I play music. I write songs on the guitar. And I don't know, I must have been a musician in the past, because after I hear a song once or twice, I can like totally hear it inside of me. So the key of having the MP3 player was that I could quickly switch between songs, and it was almost as if I knew which song I had to listen to as I was doing my meditation. And I was kind of in a meditative pose in front of these three skulls on the table. Mitchell Hedges' skull was on a Lazy Susan. I was not allowed to touch it, but I could turn the Lazy Susan to have it face wherever I wanted it to. So as I started to do the meditation, I felt the most peaceful, calm energy that you can imagine. Now, for those of you who don't know much about my background, I'm an Aries. An Aries is the type of person who would be involved in all these various activities, because if we don't do that, we get bored. So an Aries person is not going to do a meditation for a long time and sit there doing nothing. But the energy was so harmonious and peaceful for me that I could have stayed there all day and I would have been perfectly happy with it. It felt as if I was experiencing, to some capacity, heaven. But that wasn't the biggest thing that happened during this time. The biggest thing that happened, and let's see, I don't even know if I have the right words to explain it. I hope people are understanding what I'm saying so far, because this is a pretty amazing experience. But I started to feel. Now, my gift is I don't see things. Katrina can see spirits. I feel things. But the only way I can describe it is I felt there was a presence floating, let's say, to the right of the Mitchell Hedges skull as I'm facing it, like in the air. And I kind of got an image in my mind's eye. But the key is, in general, when you work with crystal skulls, you're usually having contact with kind of a specific consciousness or intelligence. It's like a person, all right? Like I'm talking to you. You're one person, okay? But whatever this consciousness, entity, being was a multi-dimensional, universal consciousness.
Something like Borg, yeah. Situation.
No, I don't think so. It was something that was part of the universe. I mean, I don't know how to describe it. It knew everything about me, and I received a message later. Now, sometimes you get messages and you don't know how do you prove this or not.
Right.
But one message I got said that could have been a higher aspect of myself. Like, you know, we have, what I believe happens in spirit is it's like an inverted tree. Okay, you have, and I've read this in books and it seems to make sense. We have our part that's here on the earth that uses only, 10% of our brain or something. But simultaneously, we are existing on many other levels at the same time. So this, I was told, could have been some higher aspect of myself, but it was not an individual consciousness. It was a universal consciousness.
Now, Joshua, our audience, especially in the chat room, as I can see them responding, are absolutely enthralled, and they do understand this. So you're doing a good job explaining that. I know it's a difficult concept, but yeah, you're rocking some worlds here. With some of this, was there a little more to that story?
Well, the only other thing I would say is that was a remarkable